Welcome back. We've shown you some architecture diagrams of how network security for Azure SQL database and Azure SQL managed instance works. Now we're going to take a look at how you actually implement and verify each of those different options. So here I'm in the Azure portal and I've navigated to my logical SQL server, so my logical SQL database server. And if I scroll down on the left, I see a lot of options, but the one I want to look at is firewalls and virtual networks. Now you'll see a few options that are selected by default here. One to point out is that connection policy we've talked about recently is set at the default. And the other that we set up during deployment is allow Azure services and resources access to the server to on. And we also added our client IP address. So this is currently how we're connecting. And like we learned, turning this to no or off is a more secure configuration. Now, since I've already added the IP address of the VM I'm connecting with, I should just be able to set this to no, save it, and still be able to connect. So we're just going to run that and do a quick test in Management Studio to make sure I can connect. So I'm gonna do a new query. Looks like we're able to connect and run a query. Now, what you're seeing down here is the client net address. So basically from DM exec connections, I'm able to identify what IP address I'm connecting to Azure SQL database with. And this matches the public IP address of my virtual machine, which I'm using right now, which is what you're seeing on your screen. Now, the next option that we talked about is actually using virtual network rules. So I could actually delete this firewall rule and add an existing virtual network. Now, to make it easy, I'm going to call this VM VNet, and I'm going to connect it to the virtual network that this virtual machine is deployed in. So if you remember the architecture from before, this is just going to make it easier for me to connect. I'm not going to have to add anything else. The other thing you'll notice is I had to enable the Microsoft.SQL service endpoint on that virtual network. And that's just going to let the virtual network know that this is going to be something that's allowed, that we're going to be able to connect to SQL services from this virtual network. So I'm going to hit OK, and it's going to validate that, and then we'll be able to save what we've added. Now that it's done, I can go ahead and save my changes, and ideally, even though we've turned firewall rules off, well, we've deleted all our firewall rules, we should still be able to connect because we're in this virtual network. So I can switch back to SSMS, and I'm just going to create a new connection, new query, and we see we're still able to connect. Now, the difference that we're seeing is now I ran the same command to get the client net address, and it's coming back as 10.0.0.4. Now, you might have an idea of what this IP address is, but what it is it's actually the private IP address of this virtual machine I'm connecting to with Azure SQL database. So that means now my connections went from coming through a public IP address to coming from a private IP address. So this is really a step in the right direction. But the other thing that we can use is this thing called Nslookup. And Nslookup is going to be able to tell us for a given database logical server what the DNS hierarchy looks like from a public standpoint. And so when I run that, you'll see a few things. One is the name. And so what you're seeing here is some actually pretty interesting information about where this database is deployed. So CR5 might indicate control ring 5. We're getting indication of the region where it's deployed, as well as a public IP address and some information about the data slice within the control ring of where this database might be located. Now, this is a lot of information that we might not want to be publicly available. So even though we're connecting from a private IP address, information about the public DNS hierarchy is available on our server. So the next thing I can do is set up private link. So to do this, I can simply go into the Azure portal and search for private link. And what you're going to see is there are a several services that support this idea of a private endpoint. So this is not just an Azure SQL database thing. This is available for other types of resources as well. So I'm going to go into private endpoints, and I'm just going to select add. And similarly to deploying an Azure SQL database, I'm going to be given a similar like blade to follow. Now I'm going to call this my AWS server, just the name of the server, and then PE for private endpoint. I'm going to put it in the same region as my Azure SQL database, but I could technically put it in another region as well, because it's just going to be a pointer to the database. From here, I can specify which resource to connect to. So you're seeing all the different options available, but I'm going to select SQL. I'm going to select the server we want to do, and that it is a SQL server. And that's really my only option here. Next, in configuration, I'm going to specify the virtual network I want this deployed in. And just for ease of use, I'm going to put it into the same virtual network that my virtual machine we're connecting to now is. That's just going to make it so I don't have to add any additional rules. My virtual machine and this private endpoint will be in the same virtual network. I can also choose to integrate it with a private DNS zone, which I've gone ahead and created here. Finally, I can add tags like we learned about in an earlier module, and add this again to my development environment. I can hit review and create and go ahead and spin off that private endpoint. Now, this is going to take a minute or so while it deploys. So once it's deployed, you'll see a similar screen as to what you see after you deploy something like a database or a managed instance, but I can go ahead and go to that resource. And sure enough, what we'll see is that it's linked to my Azure SQL database logical server, and it now has its own private IP address. So now if I go back to SSMS, I should be able to refresh my connection and still be able to connect. And sure enough, we see that I can do that. And I can even run the same query that we ran before, but I'm not going to see anything different here. And the reason is we're still connecting from inside our virtual network, similar to our virtual network rules. So since my virtual machine and my private endpoint are in the same virtual network, they can communicate using things like a private endpoint here. Where we are going to see a change is if I switch back over to the command prompt and run that same Nslookup, so notice I'm not changing anything from the previous one, we're going to see something very different. So what we're seeing here is we're definitely seeing less of the public DNS hierarchy. We're not seeing the control ring, the data slice, we're not getting any information related to that, and we're even only getting a private IP address, which isn't going to do us much use here. And one of the beautiful things about private link is that there's no change to your connection string. So you notice we set this up and we didn't have to start, you know, connecting to private link in the name or an IP address. In fact, you cannot connect. You can only connect using the standard way to connect, even if you weren't using private link to begin with. So in this video, you were able to see a survey of the options that are available for you for Azure SQL database and your network security, as well as how to configure them. See you in the next video.